I'm someone who is proud of where I come from. I'm fortunate to have a strong understanding of my maternal heritage as a Tatar and a Cossack. But since I was a child, I've carried this hole in my heart, a sort of empty feeling. You see, my father was adopted as an infant back in the 1950s, and we have absolutely no idea who his birth parents are. This lack of knowledge is something I've struggled with my entire life. But since my fascination with history really started to blossom, I've thought about it a lot more. I've been researching Tatar historical fashion in great depth, and even working on some garments. One of my goals is to be able to sew a garment from each of my ancestral origins, and so I'd love to be able to sew the garments of my father's ancestors too. That's why I'd like to thank MyHeritage, who are the sponsor of this video. They've provided me a perfect opportunity to get to know my father's heritage with their DNA testing kits. This video is going to be a multiple part series, and my intention for it is to be able to sew a couple of historical garments, and if we happen to find some blood relatives in the process, that would be a very welcome added bonus. So how has being adopted impacted you in your life?
I was always confused, and I never felt like I was in the right place. Like, you just didn't feel like I was in the right family, but I didn't know it at the time. But I already knew I was adopted from probably the time I was 7 or 8. I was probably around 18 or 19, but then one day she just plopped down all the documents and said, this is if you want to find your parents, and your father was Ukrainian. So then when she did all that, I wasn't interested. I was off to India and I was doing my spiritual quest, and last thing I really cared about was my heritage or my family. What really shifted it, jump, you know, 20 something, 30, how many years forward, was you. When you started saying at 12 years old, Papa, we need to find your parents. And I was like, really? Why? And she goes, well, I want to find them. You were on a mission. You know, and then I still was like, well, why does this matter? And then I realized one day that there's still something missing, you know, and I'm traveling, going around the world. And what I realized, all my travels, all of my not being satisfied with how things are, a lot of that is that I didn't know about my heritage, my parents, and my kind of where I came from.
I do remember that time. I remember I got on the landline phone. So I remember I was calling all of the hospitals, asking them if they had the records, since it was such a closed adoption. And you know, you were born in the 50s. It's not like it was a time when adoption was particularly open. And they were like, we don't keep records for more than 20 years. And I remember I just kept calling, and I just kept being so heartbroken every time, because this was at a time too when DNA testing wasn't really a reality for everyday people. I'm excited to see what happens. I'm excited to see if we can figure out some more information. Maybe we can find some relatives, that would be really cool. But if not, at least we'll know some of the geographical regions of where your family may have been from.
So the MyHeritage DNA kit has now arrived, and I'm really excited to take it and hopefully get some clarity on my father's heritage. Now we're going to figure out how we're going to take this DNA kit, which everything will be all explained within, and I'm going to kind of walk you through it. So I've just activated the DNA kit, so now I'm going to get to swabbing my mouth, which is going to be very fun for all of you people on the internet to see. So I've just got the unopened swabs and vials here, and I'm going to now swab my mouth.
Okay, remove one cheek swab from the wrapper and use a swab head to scrape the inside of one of your cheeks while rotating the swab for 30 to 60 seconds.
Okay. Oh, that's cool. It's not a treat right now.
So whilst we wait for my DNA test results to become available, I thought it'd be fun to explore the other features that MyHeritage has to offer on their website. They don't only offer DNA testing, but also a place to build family trees and explore family historical records. In fact, MyHeritage is the number one family history and DNA service in Europe, which is really cool. I've always felt that it's really fun to discover more about your ancestry and about your background, and so services like what MyHeritage offers makes it really simple to do so which is really much appreciated. What I really appreciate about MyHeritage is they've actually committed in their privacy policy to never sell or license genetic data, which is something that's extremely important in this day and age. So this means that you're the sole owner of your DNA data. I'm also really looking forward to seeing my ethnicity breakdown specifically because MyHeritage covers more regions than any other DNA test. And since on my maternal side, I'm an ethnic minority that's seldomly represented in DNA tests, I'm really looking forward to seeing what it ends up coming up with. All right, now that I've told you a little bit about MyHeritage and what they have to offer, I'm going to go through and actually check out my family tree. I, of course, don't know my father's blood relatives, so my tree isn't that big. But if you have a large family or a lot of ancestors that you're trying to keep track of, MyHeritage gives you access to about 18 billion historical records, which is just a phenomenally large amount of records. I, on the other hand, just have a few relatives listed here because we, of course, don't know anything about my father's side and his blood relatives. But hopefully with the results of the DNA test, maybe we'll be able to add some more people to my father's side, you never know. The other feature that I find really cool is this My Photos feature, which basically allows you to animate, colorize, and enhance old family photographs. I have this photo here of my Tatar grandmother, who everybody says I look like, and she's about my age in this photo. So I'm 25, and here she's probably about 23 to 25 years old. She helped to raise me when I was a baby, so I feel really close to her and also really proud of my Tatar heritage. But firstly, I'm just gonna pick this colorize option here and see what happens. Whoa, this is so cool. Wow. That's just amazing, wow. I really like the colors as well that the colorization feature picked for her blouse because I think these almost muted jewel tones work really well with her. And she's of course got her gorgeous curly black hair. They also have this animate feature here which basically makes your family photo come to life. Wow, this is amazing. It almost feels like I'm standing right in front of her and like I actually knew her when she was this age. I absolutely love features like this because I think it makes you feel so incredibly close to your ancestors. And especially if they've already passed, it's a really great way, I think, to feel connected with them and just to remember them a little bit. And now comes the really exciting part. I'm gonna transition over to when I've received my results. And so we're gonna get to see what happens. All right, so my DNA results are now ready. And I must admit, I am feeling a little bit nervous. I'm really looking forward to see if there are some family members, for example, because I feel like that would be a really great place to start to get some answers about my father's childhood. Yeah, I'm just gonna go for it. Okay. Wow, I was not expecting this. This is so cool. So the good thing is that we have a lot of knowledge about my mother's side of things. So because of that, I'm going to be able to pretty easily differentiate what's what. So this chunk here is Central Asian, I know is from my mother's side because us Tatars, we are Central Asian. Same with things like, for example, the Baltic countries is probably because of the Cossack in my blood from my mother's side. And then I'm guessing the rest of it is all from my father's side. So for example, the English, Irish, Scottish, Welsh, the Scandinavian, also the Eastern European. Because as my father mentioned, he believes that one of his parents was Ukrainian. So yeah, it's really cool to see all of this kind of in proof now. And I'm really excited to see if we happen to have any types of relatives. I really have no idea what to expect. So I'm just going to open up the DNA matches. No way. So I actually have a relative and she and I share 14.7% of our DNA, which is an incredibly large amount actually. And that means that she's either my great grandmother, my great aunt, or my first cousin. So that's an extremely close match. And I actually have another relative as well who is 8.5% related to me. And she is either my great aunt, my first cousin once removed. You might be wondering why I know that this is on my father's side. Well, my mother actually has a very complete family tree, so we're very aware of things like first cousins, unless there was just some random birth in the family that never got recorded, which I highly doubt. Also, nobody on my mother's side of the family has ever moved to the USA, and this person is in the US, so that's kind of what does tell me that it's most likely on my father's side. I'm gonna send some of my relatives a message now and see if I hear anything back from them. And regardless of whether or not I do, I still have lots of information to go off of here so I can actually work towards making ensembles from my actual heritage. So unfortunately, my matches did not get back to me, but not to worry, I'm not taking it personally. They could have all sorts of reasons for that. And so part two of this series, I'm going to be constructing an Irish working class outfit from the 1800s. And then for part three of the series, series, I'm going to be picking another region that I haven't decided on yet. The reason I settled upon Irish is that I actually ended up digging into some surnames based off of my matches, and just with all of the information that I had, it seems like there's a very likely chance that my father's parent, one of them, was Irish and Scottish, a lot like he expected based off of what he'd been told throughout his life. So right now I'm gonna sketch out the 1800s Irish working class look, and just to let you know, I'm not a drawer at all, so they're going to be quite mediocre drawings, but you'll at least get the point, and I'll be walking you through some of the information as to why I make certain choices. I'm using this photo as my reference, and it's a photo of a woman spinning from actually 1907. But to be honest, working class clothing doesn't change all that much throughout those decades, so what she's wearing is very similar to working class outfits of the late 1800s as well. Truly, like, when I looked at the differences between the two, they weren't all that different. I just really liked the way her outfit looked in this specific photo. To begin with, because this is going to be kind of a late 1800s look, I'm going to start with a very basic blouse. And it looks here like in the reference image, the blouse is plaid or checkered. Irish clothing at the time was quite similar to British clothing in general, with some key differences which I've noticed. I'm of course no Irish fashion expert, so this is just based off of my small amount of research. Because it's going to be a late 19th century bodice, I'm just going to make it so that the sleeves are right at the shoulder and not like a dropped arm's eye like you tend to see earlier in the century with clothing. And I'm planning to have it button down the front as well. I've got a very short torso, so I'm going to just have it stop right about here. I'm going to just add some checks here. So Irish clothing was generally made of linen and wool. Those were the two most commonly worn materials, also animal skins at some point. But by this point with working class clothing, it was already a lot of linen and wool. So this is going to be a nice lightweight wool. Then for the skirt, I'm going to do just a nice kind of working class length wool skirt. And skirts of the late 19th century for working class women were generally hitting at the natural waist here. And they would use things like sometimes a little bit of pleating or darts, but nothing too heavy that would require a large usage of fabric, because fabric, of course, is extremely expensive. And I'll probably use something a little bit more neutral colored. And then I'm going to include two more main elements. You often see Irish working class women depicted barefoot. This was apparently very common. So I'm not going to worry too much about the shoes, but I am going to make an apron. So I'll make a nice linen apron, probably just made of white linen. Keep it easy. There we go. We have an apron now. And the final element that I'm going to have above is actually something called a Galway shawl, which is a type of shawl that was very commonly worn by Irish women during the colder seasons in Ireland. It was really popular during the 19th century, and it was even worn up until the 1950s by some more traditional Irish women who were older. They were usually lightweight, and they could be knitted, crocheted, or woven. They were often a wide array of colors, so different paisleys, plaid, solid colors, or prints. I think I will probably make mine a nice lightweight solid color. Yeah, so I'm just going to kind of drape it over my shoulders here, like in this reference image. There's like fringe at the bottom as well, which I'm trying to show here. So yeah, we've got our Galway shawl here, and that's going to be my entire look. I'm really excited to put it all together. I'll be releasing part two sometime early next year and showing the process of making this ensemble. To buy a DNA kit from MyHeritage, be sure to use the link down below. And if you'd like to get free shipping, be sure to use the coupon code in the description box. And as an added bonus, you can start a 30-day free trial of MyHeritage's best subscription for family history research. And you can enjoy a 50% discount if you decide to continue it. Thanks again to MyHeritage for sponsoring this video and helping me and my father get a little bit of a glimpse into our heritage. And also thank you for watching, and I'll see you all in the next video.